Hi there, hello, it's so nice to see you. Hannah, if you're watching, hi, and kids as well, and lovely to see friends. I'm hoping people will dip in and out, and of course, there's no obligation to stay, but this will be saved afterwards anyway on my YouTube channel and on Twitch. So please don't hesitate to put a message in the chat. I can generally see the chat from where I'm sitting, so hopefully if you're finding like the music's too loud or my voice is too quiet, just let me know and I should be able to see it. Okay, so I've got my chat. I'm going to just say a hello in the chat so you can see that I can correspond with you, hopefully. Let's see. Hello. Right, so that, I think that's in Twitch, and let's see if I can also see the YouTube chat too. That'd be really nice. Take a second to set up. Right, now I don't have a look at that on another device. Okay, right, so I think I can see you anyway in YouTube on my tablet. I'm typing as Tom's Dimension on YouTube. Right. Okay, so had a really great start to Marjorie's portrait. I'm just going to take you through the different kind of scenes that we can look at. So here are Marjorie's reference photos. You can see this beautiful one of her whole body, and that's the main one that I'm using, and then another one with a close-up of her eyes. So that will be really useful for the detail that I'm hoping to do today. So I'm going to do a bit more on the whole drawing. So this is where I left it on, when did I screw it stream last? I think it was maybe Monday, Tuesday. So hopefully you can see, I can zoom in at some points when we're getting into detail. I have to kind of watch the shadows and the camera angles. Okay, but first I might just talk a little bit about materials and about the reference photo and what I'm going to be doing. So please don't hesitate to put a message in just to let me know that you can hear me. And I've just made my first mistake, so I'm using a sort of transitioning software, and sometimes I forget to switch on to the next screen, so if I do that I'm really sorry, but I usually realise after a second. So I can hopefully zoom in. So this is where the picture was left last week, or yeah, this week just gone. Here are some of my pencils. So I was just going to talk a little bit about my materials and sharpen some pencils to start with, and talk about what we're going to be doing today. So feel free to drop in and out. Right. So I have my pet box. This is an old box that I had, a chocolate box from Dubai, and I just really like little things like that that are familiar. So to sharpen pencils, I usually use a craft knife like that, because you can get a much better edge. And here's one that badly needs sharpening. So I'll show you what I do. I usually just carefully scrape away at the wood to expose the colour. And then use my secret weapon. It's quite nice to start the process, just a little mindful, get yourself all set up, clear away thoughts of the day. And I just use sandpaper, which I find really good for that. And then while you're drawing, you can actually kind of sharpen the pencil as you go. So if you're blocking in large areas, you can, and you use the side, that kind of keeps the pencil sharp. So let's get a bit closer. There we go. Right. So the colours I was using last time were really bright, and I was making a lot of use of this orange. And so now I'm going to be, I will still be using a few of those, but I'm going to be toning them down a lot. So I will show you, I made a few little tweaks to the reference photo. So if you're doing portraits, this is a really useful tip, because it's a bit much to expect kind of professional standard photos in this situation when people are taking photos of their dogs and they've got a favourite one or two like this. So on the photo on the left of Marjorie's whole body, I've actually lightened it. I've just used a photo editor and I've brightened it slightly so that I can see more where her chest meets the grass, because it was quite hard to see from the original photo where the grass stopped and the chest ended. So I can make some adjustments on my picture for that. Right, and also you will notice in the background here I've got a skull, so I thought it would be interesting to talk a little bit about the bone structure, because it's quite good to always have that in mind when you're sketching. So I actually took a little sketch, or did a sketch of a dog skull, and I was going to get the two of them out to compare. So I'm going to get, it's not a real skeleton, but it's a cast of a skull. So let me just show you. Right, so there's Marjorie. Now this is a dog skull. I'll go in a little bit. I've got a new camera, so I can focus this camera. Seems to be pretty good. Just let me know in the chat if it needs a tweak. Right, there we are. I did it again, I completely forgot to move it over. Right, so here's a sketch of a skull. The reason why I find it really good to do this is to have a look at Marjorie's bone structure and look for key markers in the skull that I can pick out as I can find them on Marjorie's face and just make sure they make sense on her. And the reason why I've got this is Steve, I call him Steve. So I find it really interesting as well to look at the comparative anatomy. So I thought it might be nice to talk for a minute about comparative anatomy. I'm not a expert at this, but okay, so what I thought would be interesting to do would be to look at Steve in the same position. So actually I'm going to move down to the drawing board so we can do it like that. I think that would work better. Okay, so here's Steve. I can get him so you can see. Right, I don't do that. There we are. In fact, I'm going to move everything along. You can see. We will get to the drawing, but I think it's really important to have this in mind. So there we are, you can see roughly the same angle, not completely, because Marjorie's slightly turned towards us, whereas these are profiles, these are the skulls. But look at the difference. I think it's really interesting, particularly what I notice in a dog skull compared to a human skull, is on a human skull you have this section here. Oh, hi Mary, it's lovely to see you, thank you for joining. So you, how are you Mary, you okay? Hope you're having a nice weekend. So this section here on a human skull is a very key thing when you're doing a portrait. So it's here, just here. And I noticed looking at the dog skull that they don't actually have, dogs don't really have that, don't really have that edge there. So they have like a almost a continuous groove going back here. So I'll be looking for that groove on Marjorie, just making sure that I've got a sense of where her eye socket is, because one of the things I was hoping to do today was work a bit more on her eye. So I hope that's interesting. You can actually see down here, if you look at the picture of Marjorie, you can kind of see where this edge here of her upper jaw is. So on the human skeleton, it's kind of the equivalent. Oh, where are we? You can see this arc here. This is the cheekbone here. Comes down. It's very different on a dog, but it's basically, they're both mammals and they're not too dissimilar. So when you're drawing a person, it's really good to try and look for any keys. You can often see the jaw very clearly in a person. That's not so clear on this picture of Marjorie, but it's really good to have a sense that it's under there. Okay, right, I think that's probably enough skeletons. They're all out of the cupboard now. So I will put Steve away. Thank you very much, Steve. You can go there. You can just sit and watch. He's very useful for portraits indeed. And right now, let's get on with the drawing process. So I'm going to just check that I can sharpen as I go. But I'm just going to check that I've got the materials I need. So I'll just keep that in the background so I can refer to it. Put my sharpener out of your eye line. And look what other colours I need. So again, I'm still going to be doing a lot of squinting, and I found the kind of ginger colour was really useful for Marjorie last time, so that's one I'm definitely going to have at the ready. White, I try and stay away from the extreme, so start trying whatever you're drawing. It's really good to to consider the sort of general colours, so the not too lights and not the very darks. Try and kind of stay in the mid-range for the majority of the drawing, and then at the end, and this is true of anything, this is true of paintings and stuff as well, and then you go at the end, you go more to those extremes, so you get the sort of general colours first. So I'm going to use those colours. I've got a chocolate brown, which is coming in handy. So to the point that I was just saying, I will stay off this ivory black. So I tend to use Derwent, I think they're called Derwent drawing pencils. Mary, I don't know if you're still watching, but if you are, I'd love to know what the volume is like. It's much more relaxed in this stream, so I can kind of discuss and I can make adjustments. So I'd love to know if the music's okay, if it's too loud relative to my voice or not. It'd be great to know. Or Hannah, if you're watching, or anyone else. So, right, and in terms of other colours, quite good to have some cools and warms. And keep an eye on that photo. So, I'm just going to look at the reference photo for a second, show you that. So, my plan to start with is to try and move Marjorie's eyes along a bit. Very lucky that I've been provided with two photos at the same kind of angle, so I can see really quite clearly how her eyes look, although they're more open in the right-hand photo. So I won't be doing them more open because I think that might look a bit artificial because of the pose that she's in on the left, and that's our main reference pose. But I will be using the colours from the one on the right. So that's the one I've got up in front of me as well while I'm drawing. And I've got a few sharp pencils, and the rest I'll sharpen as I go. And the only other tool that's really relevant is my trusty putty rubber. So here it's over. There are my pencils. I've got plenty more here if I need them. And there's a trusty putty rubber, so great for, really rubs out graphite really easily. but it also can be used to rub out this pencil, although it doesn't come out quite so easily. So I wonder, I think I might bring the camera in a bit. It might create a slight shadow, but it will allow you to see better the eye area that I'm working on. So let me see if I can. Excuse me. And try and keep it flat. There we are. Right. Okay, so I'm gonna try and focus in. Right. So, thinking about the skull, I'm looking for that eye socket, and I think the eye socket is kind of here, like that. And just outside that eye socket, where humans have got a little band here, Marjorie does actually have quite a dent. So that area there, I'm going to darken that. So although the reference photo, what you can see more clearly is the surface. So you can see that she's clearly got a white eyebrow, a lovely sort of light eyebrow going on there, or if not white, then cream. So that's like the surface colour, what you might call the local colour. But what I'm putting on here is a sort of more general shadow to show the shape. So, so I'm really thinking about the skull here. And how that falls there. And she's got quite a pronounced cheekbone, so you can see the cheekbone of the dog here, and so I think Marjorie's cheekbone, don't want to stray too far away from the main reference photo, but I think this area under here could do with being more under in shadow, really, to show that cheekbone area, because I think I kind of effectively made her face look a little bit wide in here. So, and then that comes on down here. Right. Now, I'm going to have to go in on the eye. And I am going to open her eye up very slightly. But I'm just looking for that lid area and the folds over her lid using the top right reference photo. I don't know if you can see that there. If you want to, oh, hi Astrid, it's lovely to see you. Excuse me for a second, I'll just address some of these questions. Lovely to see you, Astrid. Thanks so much for joining. And Paul, thank you for the feedback. Oh, your kids are too noisy. My kids have all, there's a three-line whip, so they're all absolutely silent. I've actually stuck gaffer tape across their mouths. Yeah, just for a couple of hours. I think it'll be fine. Thank you, Annabelle. That's really lovely. Yeah, I don't know if you mean the eyes on the picture or probably Marjorie's eyes. They are beautiful. Yeah. Okay. Right. Oh, Astrid. Well, I don't think what time. Oh no, you're here, aren't you? So yeah, lovely, lovely to see you. And please don't feel you have to stay. You can dip in and out. But really nice to hear from you guys. Thanks a lot for commenting. It shows me that there's people in the virtual room. So I'll check back on that chat every so often, and we'll be delighted to answer questions. Right, so I want to get a sense of the roundness of Marjorie's eyes and the colouring, and she has quite a distinctive white area which is really visible in the photo of her looking up, but not really visible very much on the main reference photo unless you zoom right in. So I'm not going to subject you to a massive zoom in, but that's one of those situations where it's really useful having more than one photo to work from. So I'm going to make that quite white to start with, knowing that I can tone it down. And guys, if you've got any questions, you know, about the price of fish or philosophical questions. You can, I can, you know, or drawing. So what I'm saying, it doesn't have to be about drawing, but if you've got any questions about drawing, then I'm more than happy. So I'm going in with the white just to make sure that that is reserved, like. And this side of Marjorie's face, I am going to do it as though it's in the light. So again, I've got that kind of white area reserved there. She's got beautiful kind of pronounced, I think that's, I can't remember what that's called. Is it the sclera? Anyway, right. So let's look at the colours here. So this, the top right photo is really handy for the colours. So I'm going to go in with a kind of more toned down, because she's not, doesn't look like her eyes actually yellow. Particularly that. I wonder if they are the same colour, those eyes. But she has got quite a dark area under her eye, which I can see is a like, looks like a quite a cool brown. So I'm going to go in with a lighter brown than the final result, because I don't want to overcommit. And she's got some darker brown here. It's lovely. It's like eyeliner on her eyes. I've got a lovely, lovely photo, which Marjorie's owner provided, of Marjorie watching. So Marjorie, if you're watching, hello, are you there, Marjorie? I wonder if you would hear that. Okay, and a bit there. So I'm going to check back on the big reference photo now. So I'm just looking, I'll show you, just looking at those eyes on that big one. Might even zoom in a bit. Okay. Right, come back here. Right, so it's looking a bit strange with this light area, but I just want to be able to knock it down gradually rather than and I can see Marjorie's got really quite a dark edge there around the iris of her eye, so I'm going to go in a little bit darker with that. And I think this area here, so trying to have a sense of the layers of the eyelid. So so there's the eyeball underneath, so you have a sense of the ball. And hopefully in a minute it should really start to look a bit more 3D. It's amazing the effect that this, you know, going on and going in with the contrast. So to show the shine, you really have to be quite brave with the contrast between the light and the dark. And that photo on top right that you can see is a really good example where that light is super sharp, and hopefully you can see it. Right, I just don't want to do that. I'm going to have a look in the chat in a second, so if you've got any questions, please don't hesitate to ask, or anything you want to say. How are you? Just nice to hear from you. I don't know if you can see the difference with that. Right, let me have a look in. Okay, fine, no news. Right, good. I'll just carry on then. I'll assume all is well until you tell me. I will keep checking back. Okay. So that's one of Marjorie's eyes taken a little bit further. So I'm going to do this one as well. Now, I've got what looks like, let's move this over a bit so you can see. So this eye, that eyeball, it looks as though it's too wide. So I'm just going to assume there's going to be some shadow here. There certainly is on the reference photo. You can see and catch that lid. And a top tip with eyes is just trying to make sure that they're as symmetrical as possible, unless your subject really does have pronounced asymmetry. And also to think about the rhythm of the eyes. So I think I might have mentioned this before, just remembering you've got that kind of almost like a continuous line, and they should kind of connect. So whilst, you know, we are taking perspective into account, we still want the rhythm to work. Okay, so now at this point I'm going to look at the other reference photo, so the one that you've got on the bottom, and I'm just keeping an eye. Now you can see in the picture, if we were talking about expression, Marjorie actually looks as though she's got a bit cross, particularly in this eye, and it's this key area here. I'll use my other hand so you can see. So it's this. And if you think about cartoons, you know, if someone's looking cross, they get their eyes down like that. So it's really easy to get hung up on this, and it's very easy to change. So if you're drawing portraits and they look a bit cross, don't worry about overcorrecting, because or try not to overcorrect and not to panic, because it's actually generally quite easy and subtle to change. And that's why it's so lovely that I'm working at a larger scale. So this is an A3 drawing, which gives me much more scope to capture Marjorie's expression, because I've got the space on the page. So that's a really nice thing. Okay, trying to be objective about the colours, I'm going to just sharpen that up. Okay, that's the light. There we go. Right, so I'm going to just sharpen this pencil. So when you're working small, you really generally do need very sharp pencils. And it's not so necessarily big. Particularly when you're blocking in. But sometimes you think of on a portrait, the eyes are obviously the window to the soul, and as such they warrant usually a little bit more detail, and it's very lucky when, you know, when your photo allows you to put more contrast in the eyes, because that helps. So where you put the contrast, that's where the viewer's eyes will be drawn. And if your subject's eyes are or can be made high contrast, then that's your job done for you. So, right, let's go again a bit. There we are. The tear duct on Marjorie's right eye, which is our left eye, and just making sure that's there. And she does have beautiful pronounced tear ducts, which are very characteristic to the shape of the eye, and same for human, and very helpful. Right, I'm just going to use a piece of paper. Quite good to rest your hand on a piece of paper to avoid any grease. Moving on. And okay, now let's see. So you've got so Marjorie's eyelashes will be in here in the front area. So I'm going to just leave a little bit of a. I'm going to need to sharpen this to a finer point. So I'm going to use a bit of sandpaper off camera. To just sharpen that dark pen before I go in. And also, really good tip with the putty rubber. It's really nice to periodically you can knock it back a little bit. So I'm just going to do that, which will fade out some of the things I did and give me another bash. Particularly, I want to make sure that I've reserved this eyelash area. It's very subtle, but I want to keep the distinction between Marjorie's eyeball and that, just that little bit of eyelash there, which is really important for the looking like Marjorie factor. Okay. Right, and then I'm going to go and re-commit to this pupil, keeping that reflection quite sharp, and look again at the shape of her eyeball. So I'm looking at the top, at the bottom photo. I'm looking at another version of it on my tablet, which is the one I was talking about earlier, where I've used a lightning tool, just a photo editor, to just lift the colour slightly. So I hope you can see that's really starting to look like a shiny eyeball. And right, talking of eyeballs, so now in my head I'm imagining here underneath is her eyeball. So I've got, so that's her eyelid, like, so this is her lids, there's her tear duct, and then her eyeball is under here. So I think her eyeball is probably like this, inside there. So here is her pupil, just slightly obscured by her eyelid there. I don't know if this is making sense, hopefully it is. And here's her eyeball. And then if I use a different colour, see if I can use, so here's her, the colour area, the iris. The sclera, that's the white bit, you can't actually see in the main reference photo. So that light area there is actually her eyelid. And I am going to darken it down a little bit. But what I'm getting at here, that I just wanted to show you, which is really useful for humans as well, is this here, this area. Because this is this line here is the edge of her eyeball, and it's really actually quite defined and very important for showing the angle of her eye. And on both eyes, so her right, which is on our left, her right eye is a different, that's this eye, it's quite a different shape in terms of the lids, and so it's more like this, like that. But she still has an eyeball. It'll be a bit smaller because it's slightly further away. So that eyeball is like that. And we still have this here. I don't know if this is making sense, but this line here and this line here are really important because they're basically marking the edge of the ball of the eye. So I'm going to do them now, and hopefully now that makes a little bit more sense. So I'm going in there, and looking at the same there, just to make sure I've got the boundary of the eye clear. And then I have a sense of the eyeball, sorry, the pupil. Obviously pupils, they're another key thing in terms of expression, so you can make them bigger if you want to make an expression look more engaging and sympathetic. Sometimes a good eye photo from a drawing point of view is quite well lit, and so then you get the good colour, but you tend to get the contracted pupil, which is whereas a dilated pupil is associated more with a nice expression. So sometimes you can, as long as you keep an eye on the structure of the eye, you can make use of that. Right, this area here is going to be in shadow, but I just want to make sure that where we're looking at iris in shadow, we have the losing her eyelashes there as well. How's this, guys? Has anyone got any questions or observations? Anything you want to see? I can show you more of the photos, more of the big picture, or if you want me to zoom in or out, I'm really happy. Paul, I wonder what you're working on at the moment. I wonder if you're working on a cat or anything. Oh, your portrait's going. I hope this is useful. Right, now this, I think this pupil is actually a little bit more there. Right. Right, so I'm not going to go into much more detail here at the moment because that will come later, but sometimes in terms of a portrait it's quite nice to start with the eyes. I've noticed in Paris, in Montmartre, they often start with the eyes because then the customers can see where it's going and they get really excited when they see the eyes coming together. But if you're working on your own, not such an issue. Right, warm up and brownify those eyes as they're in the shadow there, and catch that. Okay, so that eye, hopefully they look a little bit, they're not finished, but they're a little bit more convincing. I'm going to go in here, I think that needs a bit more. Let me just check the colour. They're quite gingery, I don't want to lose that sense of ginger, but it does need to be dark. So, I think my highlight is a bit big in that eye. Again, highlights tend to be symmetrical, and I am slightly cheating by inventing this highlight on this eye. And I think she's sort of looking into the distance. I don't know what she's spotted. She looks as though she's spotted something. Okay, that'll do for now. Right, now she looks a bit weird because clearly she's got her eyes developed to a much further point. I'll give you a little bit more of a close up for a minute. Right, you can see there. And here's the whole picture. I'll take that away. So, I'm going to step back for a little bit now and be a bit more general. Sorry about my camera there, but I've lifted it up to show you so you can step back a little bit. Let me cover that bit of light. Right, so I'm going to do the opposite now. I'm going to do some bigger shapes, and I don't know if it's bothering you, but it's bothering me that her nose is clearly much too light and doesn't have a good shape on it. So I've got this is called a sepia red colour, and this one is a Venetian red, which is a little bit more reddy. I'm afraid my camera doesn't stretch to really demonstrating that, but I'm going to sharpen them slightly just to expose a little bit more of pigment. Bit that goes down the middle. There we go. And I tend to hold my pencils, quite far up. Well, I'm going to sharp focus that now that I've moved it up. I've bought a manually focusing camera, which basically means, there we are, when I move my hand around, it doesn't make the viewer feel seasick. Okay, so this is quite good for stepping back. And although I've got a bigger photo here to look at, I'm actually using the small one on the screen that you're looking at, because I want to think about it from a big shapes point of view. Right. Always those big shapes. So, and if we look at the dog skull here, there is a sort of crease, there's like a seam down the middle. And I want to kind of just have a sense of the location of that on Marjorie. And have a sense of, dogs tend to have a kind of a, quite a sort of flat area on the top of their nose. So I want to keep an idea of that. And squinting just to make sure I've got the right level of darkness. Now let's have a look at those nostrils. Okay, so top tip for nostrils is I'm actually going to turn the picture upside down. So for the purposes of stuff like this, it's really good to see it as an abstract shape. So I'm going to turn my reference photo as well. And I put it down here so you can see. There, and let's turn it around. Maybe I could have a rearrange slightly. Okay, rotate. Rotate. Lovely. Now zoom in. Right. So I'm working on this nose. How can I show that? I'm going to move that there and that. There we are. No, that's going to be awkward to draw. Right. Let's put this here. Sorry about this. There. See if I can take the charger out there. Now you've got a reflection. Ah, there. Okay. So I don't know actually if you can see, but I've got a really clear sense of the shape of the nostrils. And here's another example where rhythm, like I was mentioning with the eyes, we've got a rhythm across here. So I need to make sure that those rhythms, if I was to draw invisible lines across, that they would work in the picture. So looking for those rhythms in the picture is a really good place to start. So I've got a rhythm going like this here. I've got like a light edge. It's not light, but it's lighter. And then I'm going to use a darker pencil. As I said before, I'm not going to go in with the black, but I will go in with the next darkest one to have a sense of the rhythm. So it's sort of rhythm, you could kind of read structure for that. And I've got this seam here, like that. Do you know what, I've decided to do the nose, I'm just going to zoom in again, sorry. We will look at the big shapes in a little while. Right, and I've got a sense of a rhythm going across here like that. So coming up here and down there. And it does the same, and it catches this as a protruding shape here, like the kind of lip of the nostril. And actually, this is where I find the camera lucida really, really handy for positioning nostrils. It is one of those, you know, some people find hands difficult. I do actually find nostrils pretty difficult. Because they tend to be dark as well. If they're not right, they're quite hard to change. It's really good to try and get them. Now, also, there's a rhythm going across here. So up here, if I was to imagine that line continuing there, there's a rhythm here. So there's a bit going there, round, and so I'm trying to look at the different shapes. I'm just trying to look for clues, shapes that I can latch onto. I'm looking at the shape of, if you can see this area here. Guys, if this talking is really annoying you, I can stop. So feel free to tell me if it's a bit too much talking. I don't know. It says on the streamers ABC that you're supposed to keep talking, but it is a bit of a stream of consciousness. And if you've got any questions, I'm really, really happy to answer. We'll have a look. Just have a look on YouTube. Oh, Paul, ashamed to say I haven't lifted a pencil since I was off work. Oh dear, Paul. Yes, paper over the drawing, really, really handy. I definitely recommend that. It is difficult. When you get out of the habit of it, it's really difficult to get back. I guess it's like anything, isn't it? So you can... Sometimes you just have to start with something, you know, anything, just to get back into that routine. But everything's been a bit up the spout, hasn't it, recently? So. So this is a situation where I think when I was doing the original mapping out, I possibly neglected to define this very edge here, and that's why the nose wasn't looking quite right. So hopefully that's solved that. I wonder if anyone watching is on the back to school train tomorrow, Monday, one more day. I've been hearing about people doing breaking up celebrations, end of homeschool, graduations. I'm afraid our graduation stretches to, there you go, you can sit on your screens without without us bullying you to go outside. Not entirely, but quite a bit. Right. Squinting again. I feel like this needs to kick up a little bit more, but I'm just hesitating because I don't want to go too far. Thank you. darken the eye a little bit. And tone this area down generally. Really defines the edge of her skull. Okay, so as I mentioned before, there's, you know, areas where it's really good to have the contrast because they help with the sense of focus. So you're kind of playing with the eye of the viewer and really trying to sort of show the viewer where to look. And you know, in a compositional way, you learn those cliches really about but they make sense, you know, about leading the viewer's eye around the picture, and that's probably another stage on from this. What I'm really doing now is just trying to make sure that there's a good balancing and the eye-catching bits, the bits I want to catch the eye, catch the eye, and the bits that I want to kind of lead the viewer not to dwell on. They can be noticed if it's under scrutiny, but then those ones, I can get the blue, I might get the grey out. Let's knock this back a bit without warming it up. Feels appropriate for some of this nose as well. While I've got it in my hand, her nose is looking much too saturated. Saturated is when it's got too much colour in it. I've got that in the right place. There. If you're still there, Hannah's people, you could check Hannah's nose and see if she's got that freckle. Am I imagining that freckle? Hopefully it wasn't a bit of a biscuit or something when she had the photograph taken. And she's got like an Orion's belt of dots here. I'll just put them in as markers. Shouldn't really be doing this detail at this stage, but they'll be useful for measuring. And darken this plane under here, under her nose, a little bit more. So that drops back. And then here is her. So these edges here are defining her whiskers. So I'm cutting into the light colour. Or lighter colour as a way of defining her whiskers, and there's her, I think that's her lip. Okay, so that's a sharp edge. We've got some really soft edges and then some sharper edges. And get that crease in the middle. So this is like the sweets. It's like eating sweets, doing the nose and the eyes, because they're high rewards and they really kind of make the portrait. They're sort of glamour bits until you get to putting the highlights and the darkest darks on. But sometimes I think it is nice. Those artists in Montmartre know their stuff, don't they? Okay, right. Now this is still too dark. Sorry, it's still too light. Can go in a little bit darker. Might put my glasses on for that later. Okay, let's do her other eye. Just make sure I've got that eyeball edge I was talking about. Where there's a break, where the lid splits down to the tear duct. Right, okay, now, as promised, let's do some big shapes. Okay, so just to talk for a second about where we've got to, and in case anyone's joined and you just want to see what the stage is. So this is the portrait at the moment. So you are on another camera, maybe you can see the colour slightly better. It's actually quite a warm coloured paper. It just probably depends on your monitor. And I would say we're now at maybe 45% mark on this portrait. I'll show you. Yeah. So I've got my. I'm using the same reference photo. I'm going to turn the. I'm going to keep this picture turned around like this for a little bit longer. Move the camera up a little bit so you can see. There. And just do some big shapes for a minute. Right, so I mentioned earlier that on the reference photo I've caught a better, I've lightened the reference photo, that photo there, so that I can see the shape of the rib cage better and where it ends in relation to the grass. So I'm now going to get those a bit better defined. So there's actually a shadow here, quite a pronounced shadow, and then it comes up like this. And then that is ribcage there, so I can see that. I couldn't really see that in the original photos so well, so it's quite good to have the reference photo here. Okay, and this is darker. Really darken that as a reference point, because I don't think any of this is dark enough yet under here. And it's really kind of catching the eye a little bit too much, so you know, fill in and kind of really knock some of that back. Beautiful folds under her arm. And those folds do sort of tell of the muscles underneath, don't they? They tell of the shape, the underlying shape. I'm going to really tone those down. And this whole area. A bit more squinting. Right, we've got some beautiful textured speckles in here. I don't want it to get too cool. So it's quite a. She's such a warm coloured dog. I don't want to cool her down. I have my vaccine today. I wonder who's had their vaccine yet. Have you had yours? Be interested to know. Got friends who are quite a bit young, so the age thing doesn't seem to be entirely universal. I don't know whether it's for the doctor's surgery is doing it, how they're deciding who to call when. But I know that on the NHS website, you can book as well. They're calling in people. I think it's people in their mid-50s, can book now, which is nice. Right, I'm going to have to go really quite a bit darker, and I'm just squinting to try and work out. So I'm going to shade all this area now here to knock it back. So actually from under here, the profile of Marjorie's side of her cheek, I want that to really pop forward. So I'm going to kill this lot. It's very orange, so I need to make it more golden. But also darker. So I'm just kind of considering my options pen-wise. I've got this. This is one of my favourites. I'm not sure if this is going to be dark enough, but I'm going to start with this. And gives me a chance to talk about what's called optical mixing. So when you're mixing paint, you can mix it on your palette, or you can layer it on your picture. And when you layer it on your picture, you get a really cool effect of kind of, it has a little bit more depth and sparkle. So I'm a big fan of that, and that is called optical mixing. And you can do the same with pencils, as long as you don't like obliterate the texture, as long as you keep the keep the tooth on the paper, so you don't just like smooth it, rub so much that you smooth it down. You can build up layers, and I really like doing that with pencil. So I'm looking at these shapes here. They're really dark too. Dark patch under here. It really helps that I've turned my picture around. Right. I'm just using this paper to make sure that I don't darken the. I don't smudge the picture too much. Right, and I've got a really. So here we go again. Just like there on the mouth, I'm defining these light hairs, not by drawing the hairs, but instead by drawing the shadow behind them. And just by chipping into them like that, it tells that there are hairs there. And got some of the ear folds, let's get those right. And they look on the pinky side, so I'm gonna maybe slightly over egg them and go pink. And they're certainly not that bright. Yeah. A lot of pink. There's a lot of, sometimes it's pink in the sclera as well, on the eyes. And here I can go in a bit darker, and here again, no, I'm not painting the fur, I'm painting the dark area. I'm drawing the dark area behind the fur, and that makes the fur happen. So her ear tufts. Now I'm getting seduced into the detail again. Constant battle of trying to discipline yourself not to, do that. Again, feel free to ask questions if there's anything you're wondering about what I'm doing, or what to cook for supper. Very open to questions and chat. I'll look in the chat in a second again. So if you've got any questions, do put them in, and we'll have a look. See if we can have a little chat. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to bring you in. You won't be on the video. Just muggins here. Right, so we have a shape here, there, and that there, and then this is the edge. So I think I've got a bit confused with my edges here. So I think this one continues up here. That will be better. So I'm looking at this fold here and just making sure that is the right structure. Chips in here under the ear and then this more here. And I think I haven't done enough. I'm just looking at the edge of her collar and the shape of that. She's got a, there we go. Again, showing the texture of the fur by drawing what's behind it. Such a useful trick. Right, now let's have a look at the shape of Marjorie's mouth and how I've got it here. So I'm looking for patterns and lines. So she has a, this is her chin under here, and I'm just looking for where that, I think that's the edge of her chin. I'm going to come in here a little bit and up. And then she has her mouth, which is basically, I'm trying to be quite careful about the, I'm going to creep in from the other end. I'm going to creep in from here. Softly, softly. Right, now I can see this structure here, that little bit of cheek. This is where it's really useful to have good drawing skills. So to make sure you've got the big shapes and the alignments, and if you need to, so actually there we go, that's a better sense of her cheek there. There's a border there. This bit here is actually in shadow. I'm going to use that. Okay, so we have like a, there's a crease, a nice warm crease here. That's already pretty warm, but it's so warm. It's maybe needs to be a bit stronger. And I'm trying to avoid just doing long lines as well. I'm trying to kind of break them up a bit so we have got not a sense of not making it look like it's been really roughly clumsily drawn. And if I squint, I would say that actually this whole area under here is not much different in value, that's the darkness, to the collar. So knowing that I'm going to go in on that collar later with a bit of black, I am actually going to darken it down a little bit more here. And I think, in fact, it might seem surprising, but this area under here is probably not far off finished. So I'm going to start to think about the texture of her fur, because I don't really want this area to be too contrasty, too eye-catching, or even too over-finished. It's going to be fairly sketchy and not really, hopefully, it's not the story, this bit under here. This is the story here. So I'm looking at this shoulder here now, move that along. Maybe you would like a zoom in front of it. There we go. Okay, get that shadow out of the way. Might be easier for you to move the paper rather than the camera. Okay. I know, So let's have a look at that leg then. Excuse me while I rotate. And I did say I was going to have a look in the chat. So let's do that as well. Just refreshing. Nice of you guys to... Oh, right, Paul, okay. Yes, Astrid, yeah, can't wait. Nearly there. Oh, you can't wait or they can't wait. Paul, yes. So this old man is going for my first jab a week Wednesday. Wow, I wonder what one you'll have. They tell you when they jab you what they're going to put in. So I didn't get into Oxford, but a bit of Oxford got into me today. So I had the AstraZeneca one. Not that I mind which one I have, it was just interesting. I'm so happy that you're enjoying it, Paul. Really nice. It's great. It's great that you're interested and great to share. So thank you. Thank you very much for commenting. It's really nice to hear from you. Right, so now I'm going to just look at this leg area and bring it down a little bit. There we go. And I can see, I'm going to mark the edge of the shadow so that it's a really great way to show the structure. And it's called the bed bug line. And it's basically where the form turns and you move from the point where the light hits. So there's quite a shadow under here, and that is going to help very much with defining Marjorie's chin there. And then all of this area here basically just needs to be flatter, as in less contrast. So that it doesn't jump out at the viewer. And if your paper gets, I was talking earlier about it getting smooth, if your paper gets too smooth, you can use a fixative. There's a kind of what's called reworking fixative, which you can use to roughen up your paper. It's like it just gives it a bit of tooth again. So that is always an option if you've overdone it with the layers. Okay. Right, so again, I'm going to let myself get slightly into that texture because I'm not going to do much more on this area. Looking for edges, so I can see a very slight definition there. I should think that's a what you would call a plane change, so the plane is shifting across that. There, got some contrast here where there's some lovely the way that the hairs move round the chest and over the arms like that. Oh, Hannah, if you're watching, please could you tell me, I can see on the photo very clearly and I won't broadcast it, but would you like the letters or the numbers on the dog tag? Do you want them in the photo? So I can put them exactly as they are, so they would be legible, or I can just do them as a sort of ziggy-zaggy kind of ambiguous thing. And totally easy either way, so just let me know what you'd like, either now or I can, if you're not watching, I can ask you by email. So it doesn't make any difference to the style of the picture, it's just a personal choice. Oh, and Paul, I don't know if you've got any of your boys are on Twitch, but if they are, hopefully they might be impressed to know that this is also hopefully streaming on Twitch. I haven't checked. I'm having a bit of a trouble getting it going. Enjoy watching other artists on live streaming, and it's really nice to see how artists whose finished work looks unattainably good, and watching their journey. And I found it very I hope that this is interesting from that point of view, that a thing that may look as though it's just come easily doesn't always come easily. And some really good artists, classically trained, who produce amazing finished work. You can really get a sense of the struggle, and the fact that what they do have is a belief that it's going to be all right. And that's a really good thing to have, as a sort of underneath, know that things don't need to be ditched, they don't need to be despaired over. Right now I'm just looking from this point here on the photo. There's a line, I don't know if you can see it, there's a seam here. And I'm just mentally trying to connect them to make sure I've got that seam going at the right level. And also, talking of rhythms, there's a rhythm from there to there. There's a sort of corresponding seam on the other side. Tracking. Okay, and I think this is too light here. I hate to knock it back when I've got those highlights, but it's going to have to go. It's too light. I have to be brave. Right, what am I going to use? I need a darkish, coolish colour. Let me go in with a chocolate brown. Make sure we've got that fold there. And to be honest, I know colour temperature is a big thing, but it's not as important as the value, and the value is the lightness or darkness. So that is by far the what's the word? It's by far the key player in the success of the portrait, is the value, getting those the level of darkness or lightness is much more important than the hue being exactly right. And when I'm squinting, I'm seeing that this as well, we've got some very, very subtle lines buried in those. I'm not going to draw it as a straight line, I'm just going to draw it, actually going to draw it with patching in the direction of the fur, so it will get lost as later as kind of fur texture, but I just want to have a sense of those, it's out of view, I'm talking about these bits here. Right, and I'm also going to look, so I've got a sense of that underlying cheekbone, and there, and here. I'm just looking at how it relates to this shape here. So there's a bit there, and in here as well. I'm going to take that back a little bit there, just a tad. And this can affect, this sort of thing really affects the weight, you know, the literally how fat the face is, so it can make it look too wide or too, I'll zoom out in a second and show you. Right now, I need to get this mouth bit in as well. I'm too hung up on her expression, it's too familiar, so I'm going to turn my page around again, right out a tiny bit, and rotate my photo again, because I want to see very objectively what the shape is of this. I want to get that in the right place exactly, that line that is the join between Marjorie's top and bottom lip. And I can easily see once I've turned it and it's here. But before then, it was very hard to be objective, and I can also easily see we need to knock this back. So it's really just a sort of progressive, and this is what I mean about, you know, looking at really, put that on there so I don't smudge, polished end results come from just very patiently working through stages, creeping up on your final effect, and resisting the temptation to go in with those really strong lights and darks until the very end. So on my Soggy Rabbit live stream, because those lights and darks are the they're the bit where it really starts to pop when you put the highlights on the eyes, which because I use ink on those, I do like towards the end. I do those live just because they're the real high rewards. Right, now, let me just check the time. Oh gosh, it's 25 past five. Okay, so let's have a step back. And I'll try and adjust the camera so that it's flat to the page, because that must look a bit strange to you. So just like when I use a camera lucider, try and make sure when the camera isn't flat, you don't get you get a distorted. Right, I think that's flat now. Right, so still do light under here. Going right back. Actually, looking on the screen at the very small version, it's much easier to see there the difference that makes. Suddenly, I think that's more right. So there's her nose just pops forward instantly. There was too much going on under here. I can yellow it up. It's difficult to see on the screen. This is quite soft. It looks harder on the screen. Contrasts look more pronounced. Right, and I'm going to also resist having this lot too light either. I'm going to keep that there, and she's got this lovely shadow here, and a sense of the fur moving around the leg. There. And I'm going to get that ginger pen out, because we've got this lovely fire colours on here. And then more simple colours here. Okay. I'm going to get that yellow, the lovely bright yellow. And she really does seem to have some of that on her arms there. Lovely bright orangey yellow colouring. Thank you. and a little bit here too. And then she's actually got, looks like a very slight mane, perhaps, which I've got cat with. It's like a really lovely feature, and it's kind of just, you can just see traces of it in the fur, but it's a nice, it's a really nice shape, and it tells of her shoulders, so important to get that in. But this section here is really dark and in the shadow. So I wonder what this is like as a viewing experience. I'd be really, really happy to have suggestions. I'm not at all sensitive about, I'm just grateful to people for watching, grateful for any comments, and also for any suggestions about what will make this more useful or interesting for you. Just like just to sit along and draw, see the process, or whether you like, you want to learn stuff, I'm totally easy, happy to do both. And I'm squinting and looking at this. This all needs to come down, and as I mentioned before, that's quite a sort of pinky colour. So those reserved highlights there, fluff. Okay. And then what have we got? We've got another half an hour. I'm just going to look. I'll look in the chat in about 2 minutes. So if you've got any questions, do put them in, and I'm going to work on the profile up here. So this is really defining Marjorie's skull underneath here, and just catching that edge where it's in the light. Really beautiful. Get that pen paper, so I don't want to get any grease or smudge on here. Some people wear gloves. You can get drawing gloves. They look a little bit serial killer. I'm not going to forget that chat, I will go in a second. Paul, I'm interested to know, or anyone, if you're on Twitch, whether that this is streaming on Twitch. I don't know if it's even streaming. I'm Soggy Rabbit on Twitch. A long story. Right, now, she's kind of got a halo where she's backlit, and I'm going to keep that in. And I'm just squinting and making sure that we've got, now I did put some orange on here because I can see some orange, but now I'm going, because the picture is coming nearer the end, we're not really at the end, but I'm going to start using more the real colours that I can see, and these will therefore obscure some of the orange, but hopefully just those flecks will show through. I think it's lovely. You can see sometimes on cat's fur, if you they can have what's called ticking, and the fur itself, and I wonder if Marjorie's got the same, but a piece of fur can have, actually if you look at it close up, is like a dotted line of colour. And it's maybe like the fur equivalent of that optical mixing I was talking about. So I am really trying to look for planes here. And I don't mean the sort of planes that you like, Paul. I mean planes like flat areas. Right, let's go and have a look in the chat and see if there's anything to say. Oh, thanks, Astrid. You really enjoyed it. So lovely to see you. Thank you. That'd be brilliant. Yeah, I look forward to catching up with you soon too. Thank you so much. Looking forward to our cheese and wine. Virtual. Right. So now I'm really just working my way around, catching all the clues I can find, just dotting around, not dwelling too long on one area, and looking for, if you fix one bit, then another bit becomes easier because it makes more sense, and just working around the picture like that is really handy. And I don't finish to a pristine finish, so it's quite textured. So I'm not certainly not drawing every blade of hair, but drawing just little bits. I remember my dad was an architect, and he was showing me how to draw a wall. And I realise now that he was really what he was teaching me the same principle that you can you don't have to draw every hair, and what he was talking about the bricks and saying you really just need to draw a few bricks, and that's enough, and people then understand the texture of the wall. And he gave me a very an amazing demo where he just drew a wall and a little areas of brick. And then it just looked like the whole thing was covered in bricks, but he hadn't done the bricks. It was just your eye learns then, and it's the same with hair. If you just do every single hair, it looks really dead and monotonous. So I do try and stay away from that. Lovely eyebrows in now, a real flash of white there. Great deal of wisdom and kindness in those eyes. I'd love to know Marjorie's life story. She looks a very, very, very well-loved dog. Looks like she might have had a pretty happy life so far. Line along here, and I'm not hesitant to go against the fur, not so I can see almost a sort of plane of white there. I'm going to go for it with that. Might look a bit rough close up, but hopefully from a distance it will read accurately. A really important flash there because that's showing how the ear connects in. Actually, this area is not so bright. This area as well is so bright. And here on this profile, I can go in now. A lot brighter on that edge of her chin. Okay, and yeah, so she's lit from above. So she is pretty light all across the top of her muzzle here. Those little bits of, I guess that's where hair follicles go in, I don't know. And here this edge. I might grey that up in a little while. I'm just squinting to try and see the relative darkness. Okay, so we've got a few little flashes of white in here. But I don't think I have a strong enough sense of that, this skull shape in here. I really need to improve the hints of the structure. I'm kind of just doing it with key markers of dots, you know, little dashes or dots. And I said before, rather than drawing the lines, you can just draw these in on it with little bits of fur. But having a sense that actually what you're doing is defining different planes. I sound really up myself now. Sorry. I'm not good with that. Right. Now, there's a kind of a connection from here. You can almost trace a line to there. Like that. So I'm just looking at those bits there, which are actually quite dark, and I've steered clear of them. I haven't wanted to get them wrong, and I wanted to, you know, make a bit more progress on the rest before risking it. But I'm meeting that time where I can't put it off anymore, and now I've got a bit more of the dog complete. Easier to see what's going on. So actually I can see a kind of a line going from here and tracking there. So just I'm just looking for the shape. It's almost like bands wrapping round the contours, and I don't know if that's making sense. Probably speaking rubbish, but okay, and then we've got the same here, so up over there, and then there's the odd little bit, the odd fleck going on here. I don't know what sort of dog Marjorie is in terms of, is she like a dog who chases squirrels? Is she a dog who, is she nervous around people? I wonder what she's like. She looks pretty happy around her tribe. Right, so I think what I might do, we've got 20 more minutes. I'll have another look in the chat in a minute in case there are any questions. I doubt it, but you never know. But you can always send me a question if you're watching this back and you want to know something. I'm always happy to answer if I can help. Alright, now I think for my last few minutes I'm going to darken these ears because I really want to bring that face forward, and that will help. So I'm going to go in now with the black, ivory black it's called, Any more messages? Nope, all good. Oh, that's good. I am live on Twitch. Fantastic. So, just looking at the reference photo again, let's have another look. I'll take it up for you so you can see the whole reference photo. There you go. And I'm looking on the left-hand photo, observing how, if you squint, how very dark it is. And how those, the edge of those ears, particularly the one on our left, Marjorie's right-hand ear, look at the contrast between the top of her head and that ear, and that really, really clear edge. And if I go back to my drawing board, it's this edge I'm talking about here. So I'm actually going to define it even more, because in the photo it really is very dark. And I'm going to just quickly sharpen my pencil a little bit more, because we're getting into a level of detail now where don't spend a lot of time at this level, because it can really kill the painting, kill the image. But but what I'm doing is also defining that hair. So that hair there, I need it to be really thin. I can't do that unless my pencil is sharp. There we go. And I'm also defining these hairs. They may not show up on the camera. There's another. There's some little hairs here. And then there's another quite pronounced whisker there. And there's a fold, right? So we've got an edge here, like that, and then a fold there, looking at how it connects up with this. I think that's about right. There we go. So there's a very dark area there. I'm just finding those darkest darks now in the ear. Actually using a really pure black. I'm not going to use it very much, but particularly on the edges of the darkest darks. And, right, and then this, now I've got a lighter dark, lighter warmer dark. Edge here, we've actually got quite a distinct shape here, which I don't have nearly enough contrast on. And then this, where the dark meets the light, is a really good place to put a bit of texture. So you can make it quite flat to make it believable, but without that detail. You can make it quite flat in the darks, and you put your detail right on the borderline. I'm going to zoom in if you can see there. I'll focus a bit. Right, so I'm talking about this edge here between the dark and the light, and that's the place where you can really focus that Oh, I love this camera. I'm really happy with this. Papa Look, it is. Manual focus. Dark in here, minimal detail, Hello. You're on camera, by the way, but it's fine. You alright? Oh, tea. Thank you so much. Yeah. Marjorie. Not just any dog. Wonderful. The arrival of tea, as if by magic. Barging into his Zoom meetings all week with cups of tea, so I think that's probably fair dues. Okay, let me just check if I'm using black or brown. I hope tea's brown, not black. Again, I'm just doing a little bit of chasing under here. Sometimes you're kind of playing with the optical illusions of you know, what looks dark relative to what. But often the edges of shadows can appear darker, and sometimes they are darker because you get reflected light coming into the bulk of the shadow, but the edge of the shadow is typically quite dark. Do a solid line, but I'm just doing a little bit of texture here at the same time, trying to show that edge. Okay. To knock that back a little bit, just lose some of that contrast there so that line really falls back. I'm going to lose those lights now. We can do without those. Using some of the colour of the paper as well. It's always good to remember. If you've got, especially if you're using, this is toned tan paper. So it's really good to leave some bits of paper showing. It's free colour, so use it. And I have a little, but I think a very important little crease just going on here, just there. Breaking up some of these lines look very very solid to me at the moment. Okay, I'm going to get a little bit more contrast down here. So we've got on the inside of the dog tag with a little bit of a splash of dark, a little bit of contrast. And if you can hear the seagull. Again, I'm not just tracking around the edge, just doing a little flash in there. So I'll wait to hear from the person who has commissioned the picture what she wants in terms of what information to be visible on here. And this is all a bit dark, sorry, a bit light, so that back. In terms of making things look like what you're drawing, you know, in terms of texture, trying to get, say, sometimes plums or peaches have got a real bloom on them, and it's the same like with this metal. it really is just a question of observing very carefully and just painting what you see, and then trusting that the metal colour will come. It will come of its own accord. Right then, so Marjorie is really coming on now. I need to decide basically whether to stream the last bit. I might just, for the sake of completion, stream again. I'd be really interested to know how you found that. I will turn this around and just enjoy a cup of tea. I'm going to pop the chat up. I don't know if anyone's still watching. Hope you are. Turn it around. Oh, thank you, Paul. Do you coat the drawings with a protection of some sort when you finish them? Oh, good question. That is, I'll just move that way like that. There. And you can see, and let me kill that light, and then I will answer your question. Yeah, there we go. I generally don't, because I generally use, so these pencils are very slightly waxy. I used to use pastels, so I've done a lot of pastel flamingos in a former life in Dubai, and using pastels, they're very powdery, very prone to smudging, and if you do if you're posting them or when you frame them, the powder can come down off the drawing, and so you can, obviously the quality of the materials makes a huge difference, so really good quality pastels can stop that to a degree, and what else? The thing that you're drawing onto, if it's got a good tooth, or you can draw on board. But I really like these pencils. So these are Derwent drawing pencils. So they do chalk ones. So these pencils, I'll flip onto the. Here we go, and I can show you close up. Okay, there we are. Right. Okay, so these pencils, these are, I don't know if you can see that, they've got like a, it's a kind of coppery, copper coloured band around them. There, you can see that light. And Derwent do various pencils. Don't know if I've got, oh, so these, I think this is the same brand that's got a red band, so that's really chalky, and they do them with a silver band as well, which is more chalky. I don't know if I've got any, I can't really show you at the moment, but basically these pencils are slightly waxy, which I really like because it means they don't smudge so much, so they stick, but they'll come off with a putty rubber to a degree. So if I was to scribble in black all over this, it wouldn't, I couldn't get it off with a rubber. But if it was just if it was just like at the light lines, or as I was doing with those eyes, you want to tone them down, or sort of knock them back and then redo them, then this pencil will lift off. So I would say this drawing is now maybe 80% complete. Don't know if that answered your question, Paul, but I might possibly stream the last bit for the sake of completeness. I might just talk to the people who've joined and ask if you would be interested, or might just use this as a marker and try and do another one another day. So I'm going to have my cup of tea and see, I wonder what you're up to this weekend. I think we've got a quiet one tomorrow, but we've got to get everyone primed and ready for school, so get them on a good sleep cycle, get them to bed early-ish tonight and early tomorrow ready. Yeah, and I'm waiting to see how this vaccination goes. I mean, it's absolutely fine. I've got no soreness on the place where I had it. But I know they can be a little bit problematic for a few days. So I've got some paracetamol at the ready. And now I've done this, I'm just going to be doing some recording of some drawing for Soggy Rabbit. So I'm really enjoying this portrait. I hope that Marjorie and her people have enjoyed watching it. I hope you've dipped in and that you'll see this. You'll see this in the future as a nice souvenir of your portrait. Right then, so I'm going to sign out and say goodbye and thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining, for watching. It's been lovely to have you in my virtual room. Okay. I'll just move on to my end screen and treat you to a last little bit of music. Here we go. Right, bye-bye. Thank you.